This week, our castaway is Her Serene Highness, Princess Grace of Monaco. How well could you adjust yourself to loneliness, continued loneliness?
I think it would be very difficult. I love being alone in the midst of the crowd, but I don't know if complete solitude would, that I could cope for very long. I doubt it.
Do you think that desert island situation would start up any kind of irrational fear or phobia?
Well, I don't know. I'm sure it would. I have phobias already, so I'm sure I could I'd collect a few more.
How important in your life is music?
Well, I love music, and of course we're very spoiled in Monaco with a wonderful orchestra, and we have lots of music.
Were you taught music as a child?
Yes, I was. I studied piano. Mm-hmm. And, of course, abandoned it before I was able to be my mother's great hope.
You don't play anymore?
I don't, no.
Not even for your own pleasure?
No, I wish I had continued, but alas, like so many, I abandoned.
Do you sing?
Not anymore. I used to.
Yes, I know.
A little bit.
But you don't anymore?
No.
Oh, what a pity.
Oh, for myself. When I drive, if I'm alone driving in a car, I sing.
What's your first record?
Well, my first record is a Fred Astaire.
Why did you choose Fred Astaire?
Well, I love all of his music. I loved his dancing. I love his singing. It's very difficult to make a selection because there's so many I like. But perhaps this one is my favorite.
And what's it called?
You're Easy to Dance With.
Could dance nightly just holding you tightly, my sweet. I could keep right on because you're so light on your feet. You're easy to dance with. There is no doubt in the way we stand out in the crowd. Though it's called dancing to me, it's romancing out loud. Oh, you're easy to dance with.
Fred Astaire. Now, Your Highness, you were born in Philadelphia. The Kellys obviously come from Ireland. How far back did your forebears set sail?
It was my grandfather, my father's father, who came from County Mayo to Vermont, and the first children were born there, and then they moved to Philadelphia. My father was born in Philadelphia.
Yes. Now, your father was a building worker who became rather good at it. He became a very successful contractor.
Yes. Well, one of his older brothers was also in the construction business. And when my father came back from the army, he was in France in 1918, another brother gave him a gift of money to start his own business.
And he was a very good sportsman, too.
Yes, he was.
An oarsman of Olympic standard.
Yes, indeed. He won the Olympics, the single sculls in 1920, and also the doubles with a cousin of his from Philadelphia.
How many brothers and sisters do you have?
I have two sisters and a brother.
All brought up to be good at sport?
Yes. They were all very good. I was sort of the non-athletic member of the family, but I was exposed to many sports.
Yes. Well, your father did well in the building trade, but you took after a couple of uncles who were doing rather well in the theatre.
Yes, my Uncle George was a dramatist, mm-hmm. and Walter had great success as a monologuist. He was known as the Virginia Judge,
yes.
and toured all of the English-speaking world with his stories, and he was a great storyteller.
And your Uncle George, the playwright who won a Pulitzer Prize, he had begun in vaudeville too.
Yes, he did. He wrote and acted in his own plays and then continued only writing.
As a child, were you taken to the theater much?
I was, and also to the ballet. I worked occasionally with an amateur group in Philadelphia. When they needed a child to do something, I filled in there.
And in school plays, I suppose.
And in school plays, of course.
When did you decide that you wanted acting to be your career?
Well, I suppose when it came time to finish high school and to make a decision of where I was to study, at that time I was very interested in modern dancing. Mm. I had studied ballet when I was a youngster, and then at age 15 and 16 I did a lot of modern dance, which I liked very much, and wanted to continue, and I applied for a college that specialized particularly in dance and drama, where I could specialize immediately without going through the customary 2 years of liberal arts, of general courses. But it was just after the war, and priority was given to all of the GIs coming home. They were able to have scholarships into all the colleges. And so the girls were sort of pushed aside, and I was put on a waiting list, and I'm still waiting. So then I decided I was able to get into the American Academy of Dramatic Art in New York, and I started there.
You were for a brief while a school teacher, just for a few months.
Well, yes, when I was waiting to go to school in New York, my school in Philadelphia asked me to come and help with the youngsters, mm-hmm. which I enjoyed. It was lovely. Good.
And then off you went to drama school. And at this point, we break off your second record. What is it?
Well, it's Frank Sinatra, You Make Me Feel So Young.
One of his best.
I think so.
You make me feel so young. You make me feel like spring sprung. Every time I see you grin, I'm such a happy individual. The moment that you speak, I wanna run, play hide and seek. I wanna go and bounce the moon, just like big balloons. You and I, we are just like a couple of tots. Nuts. You make me feel so young. You make me feel there are songs to be sung, bells to be rung, and a wonderful spring to be sprung. Even when I'm old and gray, I'm gonna feel the way I do today, 'cause you make me feel so young.
One of Frank Sinatra's songs for swinging lovers, You Make Me Feel So Young. So, you left drama school. What was your very first job?
My first job was in summer stock at the New Hope Playhouse.
Where's that?
That is in Pennsylvania.
And you did bits of modeling and television commercials and all that sort
of
thing?
Well, yes, I did some photographic modeling when I was going to school.
And then you played in one of Uncle George's plays.
Well, I did a couple of his in school and also in summer stock, yes.
Yes, Bucks County Playhouse.
That's right.
And then, quite quickly, on to Broadway.
Well, I was very fortunate that Raymond Massey and Mady Christians were very tall, because it was my problem as a young ingenue that I was quite tall.
Yes.
And so I lost many parts because of that. But happily, playing their daughter, it was believable, and I had my first job.
And that was in Strindberg's The Father.
That's right, yes.
A lot of television drama.
Yes, I got into television in the days when it was live and a little frantic and hectic, but mm-hmm. great fun.
And you played your first movie part in New York.
Yes, it was a picture called 14 Hours. It was taken from a true story of a boy on the ledge of the Gotham Hotel who was there for 14 hours before he jumped.
Oh, yes.
And all of the attempts to save his life and his story was revealed during these 14 hours.
Mm-hmm. It's impossible to estimate from our point of vantage down here on the street exactly how many people are here, galvanized, held spellbound by the breathtaking spectacle of a young unidentified man perched on a ledge 15 stories above the street.
This is a story of suspense-filled seconds, moments of passion and dramatic fervor. A whole city keyed to fever pitch with the heart throbs and heart pangs of exciting people whose amazing lives burst into vivid relief in 14 startling hours.
I don't know from nothing about what you think you're doing or why, but you look like a nice kid to me. I hate to see you make a bad mistake. You ought to come in and think it over. I'm going to do everything I can to get him back in. I'm sorry, but if there's any chance that he has a girl that might help get him back in, I'm going to find out about her, even if I have to be a little rough on you.
Can't stand everybody crowding me, trying to make me do things. I've got to make up my own mind.
And then what? What was the next important
thing? Well, then I was in New York doing television and also Summer Stock. I was in Denver for a season of Stock, and then I went to California for High Noon.
High Noon with Gary Cooper, a great Western. But as in most Westerns, there wasn't much of a leading woman's part. It was all sort of male-dominated story.
Yes, certainly it was his picture.
Well, nevertheless, it was a prestige movie which really got you launched.
Well, I was very happy to be in it, yes.
What's your third record?
My third record, it's called On the Amazon.
Why do you choose that?
Well, because it appeals to my sense of humor. And I find it delightful and great fun.
There's a danger zone, not a stranger zone. That little plot I walk on, that I call my home, full of eerie sights, weird and scary sights. Every vicious animal that creeps and crawls and bites. Oh, the
prophylactic sprawl on the Amazon. The hypodermics howl on the Amazon. You'll hear a scarab's scowl and sting. Zodiacs on the wing, all the stalactites and vicious vertebrae under stalagmites. While laryngitis slay all the parasites that come from Paraguay in spring. Snarling equinox among the rocks, we'll see you. And the Fahrenheit comes out at night to freeze you. Wild you are to know, are lurking in the trees and the jungle swarms with green apostrophes. Oh, the Amazon is calling.
Now, your screen career was, well, comparatively brief, but you work with some very good directors. John Ford, for example.
Yes, I was very fortunate in working with wonderful people, really.
Magambo, the Ford picture, was there a better leading woman's role in that?
Oh, well, certainly I played the second lead. Ava Gardner played the lead with Clark Gable.
He must have been so knowledgeable. Was he a good man to work with, a helpful man?
John Ford.
I was talking about Clark Gable.
Clark Gable.
But the same goes for both of them.
Well, they were great professionals, and they were very kind to me and very helpful because I was very new at the job.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a great experience working with both of them.
And then you did a couple straight off for Alfred Hitchcock.
Yes.
Dial M for Murder and Rear Window. Now, he was reputed to have had a poor opinion of actors. They were expendable. Did you find any evidence of that?
Well, it's difficult to comment. actually, working with Hitchcock was a delight in every way. He was a wonderful man, a very talented one, and with a great sense of humor, with tremendous patience. I only knew kindness and understanding from him.
Thank you.
Then, for your role in The Country Girl, from the play by Clifford Odets, you were given an Academy Award. That was a rather unusual Bing Crosby role, wasn't it? It was one of his few straight roles.
Yes, it was quite a departure for Bing to play a dramatic role, which he did extremely well.
And a very good story, of course.
Yes, it's a wonderful play.
It's my turn to holler. Love and learn, love and learn. It's a breeze, then a burn. You retreat, then return. You may have climbed the tree of knowledge, but when you love, you really learn. Love and learn, learn a lot. It's the B and N O, then it's not. It's a dream, it's a plot. It's something out of seventh heaven or something misbegot. Each morning when I count my blessings, they tally up to none. I've arrived at this.
Oh, well, the state of bliss is somewhat overdone.
Well, go, Dad, go.
Love and learn, weep and sing, till the final day of reckoning.
What about this guy?
But when arms start to cling, with the thrills kisses bring, what you have learned is you haven't learned a thing.
Take me home, Dad.
It's a dream and it's a plot.
Ah, what you thought it was not.
But when arms begin to cling
and angels start to sing,
what you have learned is you haven't learned a thing.
And then back to Hitchcock for To Catch a Thief.
Yes.
And back to records for number four.
Well, the fourth one is, I think, the only berceuse that Chopin ever wrote, and it's very beautiful and lovely.
Thank you.
For To Catch a Thief with Cary Grant, there was a lot of location shooting on the French Riviera. Was that your first visit?
It was the first time I saw the Mediterranean and was on the Riviera, yes.
Was it on that occasion that you first met your future husband, Prince Rene?
No, it wasn't. Actually, I met my husband the following year when I went to Cannes for the festival.
And then he went to the United States to see you. But before there could be wedding bells, you had one more film to do.
Actually, I did two.
Two.
Between the time that we met and we were married.
Well, the one I was going to talk about was High Society, one of the best musicals ever made, I think.
Well, it was a fun film to do. We all enjoyed it, and, you know, it just seemed to work from the very beginning.
That lovely Cole Porter score.
It's delightful.
And you with Bing Crosby in a very much lighter mood and Sinatra.
Saul Chapp? Saul is a producer who was a songwriter. Always. How did you deal with songwriters when you were a producer?
Well, that's one of my favorite questions. I'll tell you why. In almost every case, with the exception of one, I had the most wonderful time with songwriters. Particularly, by the way, with Cole Porter. I worked on, I think, four or five films of which he did the score. One of which was created under my quote-unquote guidance.
Right.
That's kind of exaggerating because he did it, you know. But my first meeting with Cole Porter was on a film called High Society.
Oh, yes.
It was one of my favorite stories. I was sent back to see Cole Porter begrudgingly. He was my idol, and I was saying to the producer who was then sending me, I said, how can I tell him when anything's bad? He says, he'll be easy, you know. I had to go back. Well, my first meeting with him, he played a song for me, which was beautiful, but it wasn't right for the picture. I wasn't going to tell that to Cole Porter. So I said, oh, it's a beautiful song. It's wonderful. He says, listen to it again. He played it again. And I repeat, I was even more effusive. He says, come here. And he sat me down on the sofa. He says, I can tell that you have reservations about that song. He said, if we're going to work together, you have to tell me what your reservations are. If I agree with you, I'll either change it or write a new song. If I don't agree with it, we'll use it the way it is. So I told him my reservations were. I said, well, in this spot, we had kind of visualized an old-fashioned kind of song that maybe their parents even sang. And I gave him reasons. This is Bing and Grace Kelly. And he said, you're right. And the next week, I came back and heard the song, which was the hit of the picture.
Oh, gosh. What an experience.
True Love.
Yes.
The song was True Love,
yeah.
Which he wrote.
Isn't that?
And our whole experience was like that all the time. And it was wonderful to work with.
Suntan, wind blown, honeymooners at last alone, feeling far above par. Oh, how lucky we are, while I give to you. And you give to me true. nothing to do but to give to you and to give to me love forever true. For you and I have a guardian angel on high with nothing to do but to give.
And the other film?
The other film was The Swan, which I did just before High Society.
Yes, with Alec Guinness,
yes,
wasn't it? And then off to a very different life to become a member of the Grimaldi family. How many centuries is it that the family has ruled Monaco?
Since the 13th century.
There have been gaps, of course. History books tell us that at various times Monaco has been occupied by Italy, France, Germany, Spain, and the Kingdom of Sardinia, but it still kept its independence.
Yes, and, well, the only time that the family was away was just after the French Revolution. For 20 years, the palace was ransacked and used as hospital, old people's home, and then the prince came back and restored the palace to the family.
And, of course, the Monaco people are seagoing people, corsairs and peaceful traders.
Well, until 100 years ago, the only access to Monaco was by sea.
Yes.
Oh, one could come from the old Roman road over the mountains and then down to Monaco. But the railroad came in about 1863, and of course that changed the principality entirely.
Well, more about Monaco in a minute. Let's have another record.
Well, for the next record, I'd like something of Bach, and I've chosen a sonata for cello and piano, the number one in G major.
The first movement of Bach's first sonata for cello and piano, Glenn Gould with Leonard Rose. Now, Your Highness, you live in that beautiful palace up on the rock. That's a very ancient building.
Well, it was constructed first as a fortress and made a little more livable through the years, but it was never built originally as a dwelling.
Do you have a strong sense of history? Do you visualize the past as you walk through the State Department?
Oh, very much so. And of course, as there have been many changes through the centuries, it's always fascinating to see and to notice and think of how it was before and what made them change in this particular way.
Do you have another less formal residence for weekends and holidays?
Yes, we do. We have a small farm in the hills behind Monaco.
And you have three children, is that right?
Yes.
Now, the area of Monaco is what, about?
I'm not sure. It's very small.
3 miles by eight, I worked it out looking at a map, but that's not an official figure.
Well, Monaco was larger until 100 years ago. It was sort of a wedge between Italy and France. And when the towns of Menton and Roquebrune and some of the others elected to become French, yes, Monaco was reduced to its present size. And at the time, Prince Charles, in order to provide employment for the people who lost their lands, as the occupation was mainly citrus growing and the production of olive oil, he created Monte Carlo as a resort in order to give employment to the Monegasques at that time.
And some of the principality, of course, consists of mountains, so all the usable land had to be used very intensively.
Yes.
Which accounts for all those high-rise buildings.
That's right.
And even to the extent of the railways been put underground now, that gives a little more space.
Yes, and it was quite an engineering feat. It wasn't just underground, it was through the mountain.
Now, of course, there's an enormous amount of revenue coming out of each square foot. What are the main assets of Monaco?
The principal source of income is through tourism, of course. But we have quite a bit of light industry.
Gambling isn't as big as it was because there are other casinos up and down the coast.
Yes, it's really a very small percentage of the income of the principality right now.
And postage stamps. So many people collect.
Yes, well, that's very important and a very big a big source of income to us.
Some of your flower designs have been used on the stamps.
Yes, they have.
Thank you. Now, there's a fine opera house. You mentioned the orchestra just now. Among your innovations is an international arts festival.
Yes, which incorporates all of the artistic expressions.
What's been going on in recent years? What have been your triumphs?
We have an important musical program. Our concerts in the autumn. We have ballet at Christmas and Easter, and also in the summertime. Our opera season begins the end of January and goes through March. We have a series of concerts in the palace courtyard in the summertime, mm-hmm. With many guest artists and guest conductors. These are very successful. We're able to seat about 1,000 people in the courtyard of the palace. And these concerts have been going for about 20 years now. They've been very successful and very pleasant.
Well, it must be marvelous to have concerts like that right outside your own house.
Yes, right inside.
Inside, yes. Although you've made no more films, you still like to perform. You've been giving poetry recitals.
Yes, this is something I started a few years ago, and I've enjoyed it very much. It's been very pleasant, and it's something that I can do without being away from Monaco for, you know, any long period of time. But this time I would like to choose a selection from a record that I made with Richard Pascoe of one of our poetry programs called Birds, Beasts and Flowers. And this is a selection from Shakespeare from Venus and Adonis, The Proud Horse.
Imperiously he leaps, he neighs, he bounds, and now his woven girths he breaks asunder. The bearing earth with his hard hoof he wounds, whose hollow womb resounds like heaven's thunder. The iron bit he crusheth tween his teeth, controlling what he was controlled with. His ears uppricked, his braided hanging mane upon his compassed crest now stand on end. His nostrils drink the air, and forth again, as from a furnace, vapors doth he send. His eye, which scornfully glisters like fire, shows his hot courage and his high desire. Round-hoofed, short-jointed, fetlock, shag and long, broad-breast, full eye, small head and nostril wide, high crest, short ears, straight legs and passing strong, thin mane, thick tail, broad buttock, tender hide. Look what a horse should have he did not lack. Save a proud rider on so proud a back.
Richard Pascoe reading The Proud Horse from Shakespeare's Venus and Adonis. From the disc Birds, Beasts and Flowers. Now, you've always been particularly fond of flowers. As a child, I believe you used to steal them and sell them. Is that right?
I mention it in my book because it was something that we did for my mother's charity. And we were chastised for having helped ourselves to the neighbor's gardens. And this career was stopped very much in the bud.
Now, this book, a book about flowers called My Book of Flowers. You formed a garden club in Monaco yourself.
Yes, I did, about 15 years ago.
And it's booming.
It's doing very well, yes. And I think it's brought a lot of pleasure to many people, and that's important.
What are its activities, apart from encouraging people to grow flowers and tend them?
Well, it's to awaken an interest and love of flowers and to encourage a respect for nature. Each spring, I organize a competition of flower arranging in May, early in May. And it's an international competition. We've had people from all over the world, and it's been very nice and very successful.
Now, your flower pictures, these are pressed flowers.
Yes, I started doing this a few years ago and became absolutely fascinated by it. And it's been a source of great joy to me to be able to do these.
Some of them are very intricate and very colorful. You gave an exhibition in Paris.
Yes, I've had two exhibits in Paris.
Now, in the book, you cover pretty well everything. The use of herbs, which is fascinating, and flowers in literature, and cacti. Of course, the Jardin Exotique, one of the glories of Monaco.
Yes, we have a wonderful garden. It's quite a unique collection that we started about 80 years ago.
You like to talk to flowers, don't you?
Oh, yes. Trees, too. Well, I love the London symphonies of Haydn, and so I've chosen one, The Clock, played by the Academy of St. Martin in the Fields.
Thank you.
The minuet from Haydn's Clock Symphony, Symphony No. 101 in D. Now, the practical problems of being a castaway, could you look after yourself? Could you build a shelter of some sort?
Well, I don't know. With great difficulty, I imagine.
Were you ever a Girl Scout?
I was a Girl Scout, yes.
So you've camped out, done all that sort of thing?
Oh, yes, indeed. So I think I could survive if the weather isn't too difficult. We don't know where this island is, do we?
We don't know, but it's not a bad island. It's got everything on it that you need, if you can find out how to use it.
Well, then I think I could manage to rig up something.
Now, what about small craft?
Do I have to have one? I suppose to get off this island, because I hope I don't have to stay too long.
Well, that's it. If you want to escape, you've got to have something to escape on, a raft.
Well, I have to make a raft, of course.
Do you think you'd manage?
Oh, yes.
Would you know which way to go? Do you know anything about stars or navigation?
Yes, I do know the stars.
Splendid. Well, fine. We'll look forward to seeing you back very soon. What's your last record?
My last record is Cacciatorian, because I think on this island I need to have something a little lively to stir the blood and keep me going. So I've chosen the Sabre Dance of Cacciatorian.
Cacciatorian's Sabre Dance, the composer conducting the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra. If you could take only one disc, which one would it be?
I suppose the Berceuse of Chopin.
Right. And you're allowed to take one luxury with you to the island, something of no practical use.
Well, I would like it to have a practical use. Well, I assume we have a record player so I can listen to all of this.
Oh, yes, you've got a solar-powered...
Very good.
Record player.
Well, I think I would have to take my two pillows that I need to sleep, because I can't sleep anywhere without my two pillows. I take them everywhere with me.
All right, two pillows. And one book, apart from the Bible and Shakespeare, which are already on the island.
Well, I think I would take a collection of my Uncle George Kelly's plays.
Mm-hmm.
Then I could keep busy playing all the parts and having a good time.
And put on a season when you got home.
Yes.
And thank you, Your Serene Highness, for letting us have your choice of Desert Island Disc.
Thank you very much.
Goodbye, everyone.